All right, good evening. We have reconvened from closed session and there is nothing to report. So with that, I will adjourn the special meeting at 6 p.m. and call to order the Elk Grove City Council regular meeting. Today is Wednesday, September the 8th, 2021, and it is 6 p.m. Clerk.
Thank you, Mayor. Consistent, making sure I wasn't on mute there. So consistent with executive orders N-29-20 and N-35-20 issued by the governor of the state of California, this meeting will be conducted by teleconference only. The meeting location will be the city council chamber, but the chamber will not be open to the public. This meeting of the Elk Grove City Council will be replayed on Metro Cable Channel 14 on Friday, September 10th at 1 p.m. and Tuesday, September 14th at 7 p.m. It is being closed captioned and will be webcast at sacmetrocable.tv. City Council meeting videos are also archived on the city's website at elkgrovecity.org. For members of the participating audience who may have personal electronic devices, please place them on silent mode during the meeting or on mute when you are not speaking. Elk Grove City Council welcomes, appreciates, and encourages participation in the City Council meeting. City Council requests that you limit your presentation to 3 minutes per person so that all present will have time to participate. City Council reserves the right to reasonably limit the total time for public comment on any particular notice agenda item as it may deem necessary. Pursuant to resolution number 2010-24, no individual speaker concerning public comment may address the City Council for more than 3 minutes. In the Zoom environment, a speaker timer will be displayed, counting down the 3 minute time. For callers connecting direct via telephone, they can utilize the raise hand feature by pressing *9, and the city clerk will run a speaker timer. And after the first 2 minutes have passed, a single bell ding will sound to inform them audibly that 1 minute remains. And when that total time for our phone call participants concludes, then a series of bells will sound. With that, as we do in our teleconference environment, whenever we do roll call or take a vote on any of the matters before the city council, we do those verbally. And so for our roll call, I will be starting that verbally with Councilmember Spees.
Present.
Councilmember Hume.
Here.
Councilmember Suen.
Here.
Vice Mayor Nguyen. And I'm looking over the list of our attendees, and I don't believe we have Vice Mayor Nguyen. And Mayor Singh Allen.
Present, thank you.
And with that, that will take us to the Pledge of Allegiance.
All right, hand over heart. Pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. All right, at this time, we will observe a brief moment of silence, please. Thank you. Next item.
I'll take us to section 2, approval of the agenda.
Can I get a motion to approve the agenda?
So moved. Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second.
With the motion and second for the approval of the agenda, I'll be starting with Councilmember Spees.
Aye.
Councilmember Hume.
Aye.
Councilmember Suen.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Nguyen. Just chime in if you do arrive, but right now I'm marking Vice Mayor Nguyen as absent. And Mayor Singh Allen.
Present.
Yep. Affirmative, that would be for the approval of the agenda. Sorry, I'm throwing
you threw me out there.
Attendance and who's here and who's not here and all that kind of fun stuff.
Okay.
We have an approved agenda.
Thank you, sir. All right, next item.
That'll take us through section 3, the closed session. There are no closed session items on the regular agenda. That will take us up to section 4, our one presentation and the announcement for tonight, which is item 4.1, which is the Arts Commission annual update. And at this time, what I'd like to do is invite Nan Mahan, if you can come on video and also unmute your side of the equation. But I think we also have staff that will be assisting with the share screen process as we go through this. And Nan, if you're out there, I can see that you're on our attendee list, and we're at item 4.1.
Yes, I'm here.
Excellent. And you're coming in loud and clear, and then I'll just look for staff if they have the presentation item.
Okay. Did you want me to begin?
think what's going on is right now, Nan, you should probably be seeing the presentations pulling up.
Yes.
For our council attendees, they'll also see your video display. So you may begin.
Okay.
I'm ready to go.
Say good evening, Mayor Singh Allen and members of the City Council. My name is Nan Mahan, and I'm chair of the Elk Grove Arts Commission. It's my pleasure to provide you tonight with our annual report. Other members, other commissioners are Cheryl Grice, vice chair, Sally Guttridge, recorder, Liz Irons, commissioner, and Leslie Sandifer, commissioner. In addition to that, of course, we have Lena Yoshimura, our community events center manager, who is the one who makes it all go around. Without her, we wouldn't be doing anything. So like to acknowledge that and say thank you to her. Our projects are pretty much grouped into different categories, including public art, Iris Awards, Laguna Creek Trail projects, special events, and community engagement. We, as you're aware, we the City Council established a percentage for the arts program, which has allowed us to beautify many of our recent construction projects, which are listed below. Let me just say that even though this has been a very difficult year, and that COVID has slowed us down, given us some objects to overcome, we've still managed to do a number of projects with the new construction funds. First of all, we have the music sculpture, which you probably have seen. It's the big note right there in the Avenue of the Arts. That's it. Isn't that lovely? In the Avenue of the Arts, which is now completed, we have a statuary that depicts each of the arts disciplines. And so we're really happy that was our final one. So we're happy to have that up there now. I'd like to move on to the park. If I may also say that the music sculpture was installed in February 2020, and the piece was created by Bennett Galleries, and that is an alumni of Elk Grove High School. So we like to use the local talent when we can. Now, in May of this year, the CN, please forgive me if I do not pronounce this name correctly. The Sing, and would it be Car Park?
Correct.
No. Opened and Ritu Atwar created two Kara, a traditional Sikh bracelet to pay homage to the two Sikh gentlemen who to whom the park is dedicated. So it's a I think that's a pretty impressive sculpture there also. When the preserve opens later this year, the preserve that we'll be having toward the back of District 56, when it opens later this year, it will feature a cultivation near the corner of Big Horn and Lots Parkway. And this kinetic artwork by the Ride Art Studio will feature leaves that move with the Delta breeze in an area back there, which plays a tribute to Elk Grove's agricultural history. So I think that should be quite impressive. This Martin Webb is the artist who is currently designing these figures for Oasis Park. The featured figures, which are depicted in brown and engage students and adults alike to interact with them. I'm sure it's mostly children, however. And this is a rendering of the piece. The actual sculpture will be made of stainless steel with designs etched into them. Old Town Plaza is still in the design phase. We look forward to presenting you with a final design in the near future. I think it's going to be a design that you will approve of because it's historical in nature. The besides just the artwork, visual artwork, the commission likes to honor local artists for their achievements. Now, these local artists must have a book of work. They must have done something to use their art to help the community, and they must be professionals. So the ones that we honored this year was Literary Arts, was Laurie Holter, Patron of the Arts, Kirsty Kreifrauser, Performing Arts, Musical Mayhem Productions, Rising Star, Carly Rhodes, and Visual Arts, Yvonne Bonacci. They have all made their mark. Oh, please don't keep that picture up there. They've all made their mark on the world of art in our community, and we're very proud of them. The Laguna Creek Trail Project is it's something that our commissioners really wanted to do. We're working with the Trails Committee to beautify that area, and also to do some artwork on the walls of that bridge, which are very bland looking at this moment. We're going to also put signage along the Laguna Creek Trail to inspire people with art and quotes from artists, inspirational things, perhaps something from Maya Angelou or something. We haven't decided on all of the quotes yet, but I think they will make walking that trail much more pleasant. And of course, a project close to my heart is the 11 piece musical review, which will take place on Friday, September the 24th at 7 p.m. at that beautiful theater in the Sun Grove Church. This event has been very popular in the past, the ones we've done. This one, I think, is our best one. It will feature music from the 60s, that nobody has ever outgrown the music from the 60s. I know 10-year-old kids that are still singing the music from the 60s. And so I'm sure all of you have memories of those good songs too. We are also asking participants to come dressed in theme attire. So I have little old ladies out buying tie-dye shirts and flowers for their hair. They're all excited about it, and I think this is going to be a great show. And particularly, the tickets are only $10. You can't go to the movies for that. And we will feature 10 of the most popular professional singers in the Elk Grove and Sacramento region. So you'll want to hear them, because I don't know where else you're going to hear them for $10. It's something that we've never done before, is the Great Read Book Fair, which will take place on Saturday, October the 9th. It's an all-day affair. We encourage people to bring their children, because we're going to have outdoors. We'll have three storytellers back to back. And then we will also have an open mic for poets, so that they can come in and read their work. And then, of course, we will have authors with their books for sale, children's books, mystery books, romance, whatever you like to read. I'm sure that you'll find an author there. Most of that is happening out on the Avenue of the Arts. Inside, we will be having a writer's conference where writers can learn their craft by listening to other great speakers, writers who have something to help them, educate them, or help them along their way as a writer. This year, also, we are engaging the community as much as possible. We have a utility box beautification. As you know, we have already done a few of those. We've selected three artists to create three more utility box art scenes at various locations throughout the city. And we'll be presenting at a future city council meeting, we'll be presenting their renditions. We did also help review the arts grants that the city granted this year. We are visible in the community by hosting booths at the Neighbor Good Market and the CSD Summer Concert. All the commissioners showed up and took turns sitting in the booths, so that we could get the word out about our events coming up. We faced a lot of challenges this year, but we continue to do our work to bring art to the community. And so I'd like to thank you for allowing me to share our work with you, and ask if you have any questions.
Thank you, Ms. Mahone. Great presentation. I just wanted to recognize all of your tremendous work, along with your fellow committee members, commissioners that serve and continue to invest in the arts, which is still so critical and important. I just wanted to thank you again for your service and as part of the Arts Commission. Continued success.
Well, thank you very much. And we are grateful for any support we can get. I'm hoping that we will see you at our show on the 24th. And please come in costume. It'll be a lot of fun.
Sounds good. We might have to have a council competition on that. I see Council Member Soon's hand raised.
I'm sorry, I'm having trouble hearing you.
Oh, I just called on Council Member Soon to speak.
Thank you, Mayor. Hi, man. I just wanted to say hello. It's so good to see you. And thank you, Mayor. I think maybe I'll take you up on that challenge. We'll have to dress up. I just wanted to thank you, Nan, and the entire commission for continuing to keep our city beautiful with all the different art projects going on, and congratulate all the Iris Award winners. So thanks so much for all your hard work.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Any other council members? I don't see any other hands raised. You can unmute. If not, we will move on to our next item. Seeing no other hands raised, thank you again, Ms. Mahone, for joining us this evening. Have a great evening, and I look forward to seeing other updates for the year, and hopefully I'll see you in a few weeks dressed in some sort of 60s attire.
Thank you.
All right, we will move on to our next item.
Okay. And that next item will be section 5, general public comment. For any of our attendees in the Zoom audience, now would be that opportunity for you to start using the raise hand function in order to queue yourself in line for general public comment. Members of the audience may comment on any item not on the agenda that is of interest to the public and within the subject matter jurisdiction of the City Council. Each person will be allowed 3 minutes or less if a large number of requests are received on a particular subject. The City Council cannot take action on non-agendized items raised under public comment until the matter has been specifically included on an agenda as an action item. Members of the public desiring a response to a specific question are encouraged to contact any member of the council or the city manager at any time. Those audience members who wish to address a specific agendized item are encouraged to offer their public comments during consideration of that item. I am turning my attention back over to our listing of attendees. I am not seeing any attendees using the raised hand function. And just to touch base, Mayor and council members, we did not receive any prior written comments under general public comment. What I do see is, as I've been speaking, we have one individual who has used the raise hand function. I will pull up the speaker timer now.
Diana Rosales, you may go ahead. You have 3 minutes.
Yes, good afternoon, council. Good afternoon, mayor. My name is Diana Rosales. I'm a resident here 22 years ago. I relocated from New York to Elk Grove. I did voice a concern, and I did put it in on the mayor's through her secretary. It went through voicemail, and your secretary, I believe, did get the information. So I do want to go ahead and voice my opinion. I'll be very brief. It's due to public safety. I did get a chance to speak today to the public engineer, Mr. Chapman. There is a concern here on Brashaw and Bond. It is due to safety for the children. There is no clear crossway for children with disabilities. We have children that have disabilities, autistic, ear impairment, and blind. And most of the residents have kind of here in where we live have voiced their opinion, but unfortunately it has not been resolved through the district. And I know that you guys don't have jurisdiction for the school district, but I know that you as a mayor have come from that environment, and also the ex-mayor has also come from that environment. And I wanted to see if there was a way that you can possibly as a friendship help me, because unfortunately they have not hired somebody to do those things, which is like, I guess that they're, I think their engineer, that's what they told me. So anyway, the situation is that children are left with very disoriented when they're crossing the street. In my incident, I'm reaching out because my son personally, and I did file a police report, was about to hit by a semi truck in this conjunction, because now you're having a light post changing, you're having the casino going through there, and there's other buildings that are going around there. So I wanted to see if the city can help me, and also with the city public engineer, put some clear signage with good hearing so that children that are blind can hear, and see if we can do something in terms of that, because it is public safety. The children this year, the school has got an overflow of 1,000 children more in Catherine Arbiani. Another 1,000 have joined Pleasant Grove High School. So I am voicing my opinion as a protective mother, which any mother would do if a tragedy, God forbid, would happen to any children. Thank God that did not happen to my son, and the parents were diligent. The truck driver was very scared, but I did file a report. So I do want to voice my concern on that, on public safety for the children, especially kids with disabilities.
Thank you, ma'am. I will be calling you tomorrow. Thank you for calling in.
Thank you.
Any other callers?
This will be the last call. I do not see any raised hand features being used for general public comments, so that'll conclude public comment.
All right, then we will move on to our next item.
And that next item will be section 6, general administration information.
All right, good evening, Madam Mayor, members of the City Council, Jason Behrman, City Manager, with a few items to report on this evening. First of all, related to Northern California wildfires, city resources have been deployed to provide mutual aid to several Northern California communities in the past few weeks. Police Department has filled 67 12-hour shifts between the River, Dixie, and Caldor fires. Animal Services staff have filled 10 animal control shifts and shelter assists on the Caldor fire. Our police department has also coordinated the statewide mutual aid response for dispatchers to the Caldor fire, consisting of 104 dispatch shifts from agencies as far south as Santa Barbara County to as far north as Humboldt County. Please join me in thanking our police department personnel for their service to communities near us who need help during this difficult time. Now, an election update. Next Tuesday is the last day to vote in California's gubernatorial recall election. City Hall is one of the county's official ballot drop-off locations, and voters can drop off their ballots in the city clerk's office on weekdays from 8 to 5. The center at District 56 will open as one of the county's official vote centers beginning this Saturday, September 11th. Residents can go there September 11th through the 13th from 9 to 5, or on election day from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. to vote in person, solve voter registration issues, get a replacement ballot, and receive assistance with accessible voting devices and language assistance. Details and other drop-off and vote center locations can be found on Sacramento County's website. There is an upcoming pet vaccine clinic. Animal Services will host a drive-through pet vaccine clinic on Saturday, September 18th. From 9 a.m. to noon, free vaccines and microchips for Elk Grove pets will be available. Staff expects to vaccinate 150 to 200 pets. Clinic will be held in the parking lot of our animal shelter, 8220 Longleaf Drive. Details are available on the Animal Services Facebook page. Story time with Chief Albright and Mr. McCaw. The police department will host a special story time event on Wednesday, September 15th at 6 p.m. at District 56 with Letitia Ordaz, award-winning author and publisher of The Adventures of Mr. McCaw. Chief Albright and Letitia will read The Adventures of Mr. McCaw in English and Spanish. One free edition of the book will be given to the first 50 kids, 12 and under. Our police department will also host a virtual summit for the Business Watch program on September 23rd at 10 a.m. via Zoom. Business Watch is a crime prevention program designed for businesses in the city of Elk Grove and modeled after the Neighborhood Watch program. Businesses located in the same shopping center can work together in partnership with PD to prevent and reduce crime. Businesses that are interested, contact Officer Ramirez at jramirez@elkgrovepd.org to register or get more details. And as Nan recently talked about, we have our Peace and Love musical review that's coming up on Friday, September 24th at Sun Grove Church. Really looking forward to that event. Diversity Inclusion Commission will host a new Cultural Connections event on Thursday, September 30th at the Center of District 56 at 6:30 in the evening. The event will celebrate Hispanic Heritage Month by presenting 5 short TED-style talks from the Elk Grove Hispanic community. We'll share their unique stories, insights, and perspectives on life and their cultural identity and influences. Visit the city's website for the lineup of speakers and other event details. And finally, a quick events update with COVID and other things happening. Some groups are finding ways to move forward with modified events this year. Others are choosing to postpone their plans to return given the recent increase in COVID-19 cases and hospitalization rates in our region. The city works with a number of these organizations through the event sponsorship grant program, and we were notified recently that the Veterans Day Parade, for example, will not be held this year. Organizers cited health and safety concerns for a large percentage of our elderly veterans in the city. Other fall events like the Giant Pumpkin Festival, the Gobble Wobble Run, the Dixon's Fair, and the city's Holiday Lights Parade are all being planned with COVID-19 safety protocols in mind and are still on schedule. City staff will continue to share information on event changes on the city's website and on social media platforms as they become available. And that concludes my report. I'm happy to take any questions the council might have.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Bierman. Excellent report. I don't see any hands raised by my colleagues. So thank you. And we will move on to our next item.
Our next item would be section 7, the consent calendar items.
All right. I would like to go ahead and open the public comment opportunity.
And for our participants in the Zoom environment as attendees, now would be the time to use the raise hand function if you have comments on our consent calendar items. Mayor and council members, there were no written comments that were submitted prior to the meeting on the consent calendar. As I'm going over the list of attendees, I do not see any raise hand functions being utilized. That'll conclude public comment.
All right, I'll close the public comment opportunity and open it up for a motion to approve the consent calendar.
Soon, move approval of consent.
Spees, second.
All right, we have a motion and a second.
And with the motion and the second, I will start the roll call vote, starting with Councilmember Spees.
Aye.
Councilmember Hume.
Aye.
Councilmember Suen.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Nguyen is absent, and Mayor Singh Allen.
Aye.
With that, the consent calendar items will all be approved 4-0 with one marked absence for the vice mayor. And that will take us on to our next section, which is section 8, our public hearings, starting with item 8.1, which is a public hearing to consider the establishment of rules for the administration of agricultural preserves and the implementation of the California Land Conservation Act or Williamson Act.
Good evening, Madam Mayor, Council Members, Christopher Jordan. So as Jason mentioned, this item is establishing rules for the preservation of ag land under the Williamson Act. Quick background for you. In 1965, the state enacted the Williamson Act, or the California Land Conservation Act, as a mechanism to protect shrinking agricultural lands around the state by creating incentives for property owners through reductions in their property tax. This occurs through what's called a Williamson Act contract, which is essentially a contract between the local agency, oftentimes a county, but sometimes a city, and the property owner, which occurs on a rolling 10-year basis. In exchange for continued agricultural production on the site, they receive these property tax benefits. Before a property can be placed into a Williamson Act contract, an agricultural preserve must be established over the subject property, or at least inclusive of the subject property. And these occur through a action of the local agency. So they're set by the local agency in terms of where these may be. Preserves themselves actually do create a level of limitation in terms of the type of subdivisions of land that can occur and the types of land transactions that may occur. Generally speaking, most jurisdictions apply a one-to-one relationship between the preserves and the contract areas, although some counties around the state do set larger preserve areas and then have individual contracts occur on a case-by-case basis. So the issue for us this evening, there are a number of properties around the city which have historically had Williamson Act contracts on them. Many of these have gone non-renewal under either the county before incorporation or with the city after incorporation. So these contracts are no longer in effect. There's no property tax benefits incurred by the underlying property owner, and no requirements for agricultural production. However, in reviewing project files, we identified that the underlying preserve designation in nearly every case has not been removed. So we'd like to come through and do cleanup on those projects and those properties over time. We anticipate some coming forward in the next few months. However, pursuant to state law, before that can happen, the city must first adopt rules for the administration of preserves and the implementation of the Williamson Act. We've not found any of these on file for the city, so we're proposing them this evening. The rules are attached to your packets. I won't go through them in extensive detail, but I will highlight that these are submitted to the Development Services Department, reviewed by the director, reviewed by the Planning Commission, and ultimately taken action by the City Council. Pursuant with state law, the requirements for establishing a preserve and a contract would be that these are a minimum of 100 acres in size, although multiple underlying properties or assessable parcel numbers can be included within one preserve or one contract. And consistent with our general plan, these sites would need to have a general plan designation of agriculture and have zoning designations of Ag 20 or Ag 80. The proposed rules are consistent with the city's general plan and further protection of agricultural lands from conversion and limit the siting of projects with land uses that might result in conflicts near existing agriculture due to noise, air quality, or odors. No further environmental review is required for the rules as they're consistent with the general plan EIR that was previously certified in 2019. So staff's recommendation and the recommendation from your planning commission is to adopt the attached resolution, finding no further environmental review is required, and adopting the proposed rules for administration of the Williamson Act. Includes my presentation, available to answer questions if you have them.
Thank you, Mr. Jordan. I will declare that the public hearing is now open and open the public comment opportunity.
For our members of the attendee Zoom audience, now would be that opportunity to use the raise hand feature in order to speak on item 8.1. Mayor and council members, there were no written comments that were received in relation to item 8.1. Taking my attention back over to the list of attendees, and I do not see any raised hand functions, that will conclude public comment on item 8.1.
All right, thank you. I will go ahead and close the public comment opportunity and declare that the public hearing is now closed. And any council members have any questions? Otherwise, I will entertain a motion.
Just a quick question, Mayor. Christopher, the parcel that was identified that had applied for non-renewal, I think it said back in 1980 or thereabouts, had it just not been recorded as having and been removed from the act, or what was the title still clouded?
Yeah, there was a title on cloud essentially in this particular case that triggered our review. The Williamson Act contract itself had gone non-renewal, and the non-renewal had been recorded by the county, but the underlying preserve designation had not been removed by concurrent or separate action. There was no reference in any of the county materials that the preserve was coming off concurrently with the non-renewal, and there was no subsequent board action that we've been able to find. We've asked the county repeatedly for any additional documentation, and we've not found anything that we believe satisfies the requirements of the Williamson Act.
Okay, thank you. With that, Mayor, I would move the item.
Thank you. We have a motion and we have a second.
Second, yeah.
With the motion and the second for the resolution of item 8.1, I will start that roll call vote with Councilmember Spies.
Aye.
Councilmember Hume.
Aye.
Councilmember Soane.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Nguyen is absent, and Mayor Singh Allen.
Aye.
With that, the resolution of item 8.1 will pass 4-0.
All right, next item.
I'll take us on to item 8.2, which is a public hearing to consider an amendment to the uniform sign program for the Civic Center South Property Project, AKA District 56.
My apologies, Madam Mayor. I think my system is getting a little overloaded. Give me a moment.
My screen just went black. Is that for everyone or just mine?
Mine's okay. I'm showing Christopher's. There it is.
Yeah. There it is. Okay. Yeah. My
apologies.
Screen just went all dark for some reason.
I think it's graphic. Okay.
Small crash on my end.
Okay,
thank you.
No worries. We're back.
So this item before you is an update to the uniform sign program for District 56. Short background, in January of 2017, the council approved the uniform sign program for the Civic Center South property, what we now refer to as District 56, which is the site with the community center, the aquatic center, and future siting for the Library Performing Arts Center and the upcoming opening of the preserve area. In September of 2019, the council approved branding for the site as District 56 and naming it as such. So you can see there that there's that time difference between those two actions. The uniform sign program is an important approval for the site, and we require this of many non-residential projects around the city. This creates an opportunity to integrate the design, aesthetics, and character of the signage that's on the site with the structures in order to achieve a unified aesthetic and some sort of cohesive design across the site. For this particular property, again, the site had a uniform sign program approved in 2017, and we're requesting this evening to augment it with the branding for District 56 itself. This would occur through two particular signs, one a modification to an existing sign and the other a new sign type. So first, we'd be updating the primary monument signs, which are located at the driveway at Denali and Bighorn, as well as the driveway into the parking lot nearest the community center off of Civic Center. These are the primary monument signs which identify the entrances to the site. These would be updated, as we'll show in the next slide, to add the lettering for District and 56 atop the sign. The second sign would be a new wayfinding sign to be oriented towards pedestrian traffic, and this would occur at three locations, predominantly in the preserve area or entrances to the preserve. First at the end of the drive aisle coming in off of Bighorn, and then at two locations off of Lots Parkway near Mallet and near the intersection of Bighorn. So the design of those signs is shown here. As you can see, the primary signage, the monument sign on the left, we would take the existing concrete wall with the existing Senior Center Veterans Memorial lettering or Aquatic Center lettering, as would be the case with the two signs, and augment it with the words district and then the logo for District 56 atop it. For the secondary signs, this would be a new metal sign similar to the wayfinding maps that are out there today. It would add at the top of it the District 56 logo and also include the city logo etched into the steel as well. And those would all be powder coated to make match the existing character. So the staff's recommendation is that you find no further environmental review is required for this action and approve the proposed amendments to the uniform sign program for the project. Includes for my presentation. I'm available as well as staff from Capital Improvement Program to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you, Mr. Jordan. I will go ahead and declare that the public hearing is now open and open the public comment opportunity.
For our attendees in the Zoom environment, now would be that opportunity for public comment on item 8.2. Mayor and council members, there were no written comments that were received on item 8.2 prior to the meeting. And as I go back over our list of attendees, we do have a member of the public. If I could just ask staff to pull down their share screen, and then I will pull up the speaker timer.
Diana Rosales, you may go ahead. You have 3 minutes.
Hi, I just was wondering, as a citizen from Elk Grove, what's the cost of the sign? Thank you.
All right, we can answer that during our Q&A here afterwards. Are there any other callers?
And as I look over the list of attendees, we don't have any further raised hands, so that would conclude public comment on item 8.2.
Okay, I will go ahead and close the public comment opportunity and declare that the public hearing is now closed. And per the caller's request, Mr. Jordan, can you provide us an update on costs?
I'm actually going to defer to either Jeff Warner or John Griffin from Public Works. They may have that information better than I would.
Okay. Are they available?
Hey, good evening, Madam Mayor, members of the City Council. This is Jeff Warner, your Public Works Director. Yeah, we do have a bid for the signage project. The total project cost for construction is around $85,000. And that includes multiple signs throughout the campus, including the ones shown in the renderings this evening.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Werner. All right. Any other questions or comments from colleagues? Otherwise, I will look for a motion. Seeing none, can I get a motion?
This is Spees. Move item.
Hume, second.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second.
And with the motion and the second for the resolution of item 8.2, I will start with the roll call vote. Councilmember Spees.
Aye.
Councilmember Hume.
Aye.
Councilmember Soon.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Nguyen is absent. And Mayor Singh-Allen, pardon me.
Aye.
The resolution for item 8.2 will pass 4-0.
All right, next item.
Take us on to section 9, our regular agenda action items and recommendations, starting with item 9.1, which is consider a resolution authorizing the city manager to execute a purchase and sale agreement and joint escrow instructions and a public improvement agreement with Kubota Corporation, foreign related to the sale and development of a portion of city-owned real property located at 10251 Grantline Road, a portion of APN 134-0190-0000.
Good afternoon, Madam Mayor and members of the council. I'm Daryl Doan, your Economic Development Director. Jason, are you hearing and seeing my presentation, hearing me and seeing presentation.
Indeed, audio and visual coming through loud and clear. Mr. Dunn, please proceed.
Okay, thank you very much. So the item in front of you tonight is the sale of a portion of city-owned property located at 10251 Grantline Road to the Kubota Tractor Corporation. And so our recommendation is that you adopt a resolution that authorizes the city manager to sign two agreements, a purchase and sale agreement, which would sell the property and provide escrow instructions for closing on the transaction, and a public improvement agreement, which I will describe a little bit later. There's a lot of history here. I'm going to run through it quickly. This is the culmination of over 3 years of effort, and actually goes back to 2014 when we acquired the subject property. So we acquired approximately 96.23 acres of land in August of 2014 in Sacramento County, adjacent to the city limits off Grantline Road. And we paid about $4 million for that. That acquisition was originally intended for the construction of a multi-sport field complex. In September of 2015, sports complex plans were presented by staff to council. Staff was directed at that time to scale back the project and identify a revenue neutral approach to the project. Unfortunately, we were not able to come up with a project that met those goals, particularly the revenue neutral approach as regards a sports complex. So we started looking at other options at some point. So in March of 2020, the council declared the property surplus and identified at that time industrial development as a prospective use. In January of 2021, a supplemental EIR was certified by the council for the annexation of the land that you see here, if you follow my cursor. And that supplemental EIR evaluated industrial use as a project alternative. In May of 2021, the council directed staff to abandon the sports complex project and proceed with sale of the land and development of the land for industrial purposes. And in June of 2021, the Local Agency Formation Commission, AKA LAFCO, another governmental body that approves annexation, they approved the annexation of 382 acres, which you see outlined in the dashed line here, into the city. And that includes the city's 96-acre site, which you see highlighted in green here, colored purple, labeled light industrial. So that's a little bit of property history. The project history, as I said, goes back over 3 years at this point. So in February of 2018, economic development staff engaged a company called Kubota in talks to relocate and expand a facility that they have currently in Lodi to Elk Grove. Now, this was a competitive multi-city and state search, one that I am proud to say that we won after a lot of years of work and effort. In July of 2020, Kubota and the city entered into a letter of intent. The purpose of that letter of intent was to negotiate a sale transaction of city land to put their project on a portion of our 96 acres, among other things. In March of 2021, Kubota submitted a project application to the city. And in July of 2021, the Planning Commission approved that project. I want to highlight here that delta between March and July. That is remarkable, I don't mind saying, for a project of this size. And I want to thank our development services department for doing a fantastic job getting a project of this complexity from application in March to Planning Commission approval in July. In August of 2021, the council approved that same project on appeal. It was appealed out of the Planning Commission and then was elevated to the council. It was appealed on the basis of a challenge to the environmental analysis that was done to the project. You denied that appeal in August and approved the project. There's a grading permit for the project that is nearly ready to be issued. So this project is not speculative. If we consummate this transaction here in the next couple of days, construction is slated to move forward imminently. And there's a target opening of Q2 2022. You can see over here on the right, the specific project location, which is a portion of our 96 acres. So who is Kubota, the purchaser? They are now our partner, and they are a multinational Japan-based corporation that will be locating a major facility in Elk Grove. They were formed in 1972. Kubota North America Corporation is an American corporation. They were formed in 1972. They are based in Grapevine, Texas. They are a U.S. subsidiary of Japan-based Kubota Corporation, which was founded in 1890. They are manufacturers of tractors and heavy equipment for agricultural and construction industries. As I noted, Kubota Tractor Corporation, that's the entity that will actually purchase the property, should you so approve. They are a subsidiary of Kubota that distributes tractors to its U.S. dealership network, among other things. As I noted, they have a Lodi, California distribution center that they seek to relocate and expand, and they seek to do that here in Elk Grove. So the project description, it's to be known as the Kubota Western Distribution Center. You can see renderings on the right here. I want to note the elevated design. Most, if not all, industrial properties in the Sacramento region are a big square box, and your design elements might include a colored stripe. This is much more than that. It is elevated at the city's request and at the applicant's insistence, frankly, that this be a signature building that is a gateway into this area and a building that reflects their corporate values. The purpose of the project of this distribution center is obviously warehouse distribution. There will be light assembly of tractors and components before they are shipped out to dealerships. It will also serve as the company's Western division offices. So there will be executives doing work in our city every day from this company. What they seek to do is acquire a plus or minus 43.76 acre acquisition property from the city. That is a portion of our 96 acre property. I'll show you a map in a moment. They wish to construct an approximately 631,500 square foot building on a 31.53 acre portion of that 43.76 acre acquisition property. I mentioned elevated industrial design. We think that's wonderful. It's approximately a $60 million capital investment. At peak employment, at stabilized occupancy, we expect between 125 to 150 jobs. It might be closer to 125. This is not a jobs-dense project. That is, frankly, not necessarily or always the purpose of economic development, but 125 jobs is good. 400 temporary construction jobs is good. The project will also be the home of Kubota University. That is a training center where dealers and staff will be trained on the products that they sell. There's a 12.23 acre future expansion parcel. So if you subtract the 43.76 acre acquisition property, if you subtract the 31.53 acre project parcel from the acquisition property, you're left with a 12.23 acre parcel that will be purchased and owned by Kubota and will be held for some sort of future expansion project. There's also a 7.13 acre stormwater detention parcel. And also at the end of the day, the city will retain almost 40 acres of its 96 acre property. And we will use that for, hopefully, for future sale and development opportunities similar to this of an industrial nature. The project also includes the construction of Waterman Road south of Grantline Road to the city's remainder parcel. It also includes, although I haven't noted, wet and dry utilities being extended onto the site and down that road closer to our remainder parcel. And so here is a map. This will maybe hopefully start to make it make sense. So this is the approximately 35-acre project parcel. And then this is the approximately 12-acre remainder parcel, if you're following my mouse here. And this is the 7-acre or so detention basin parcel. And then this is our 40-acre or so remainder parcel. I apologize if not all of that is readable. It is on my screen. I don't know what it looks like on yours. So the purchase and sale terms. So first, I want to point out the green sheet that we sent you today before I go any further. In the resolution that was published, there was an error in the purchase price. It read $5,200,000. That was simply an error. The green sheet corrects that to the proper purchase price, which is referenced in the staff report of $5,150,000. Also, the resolution incorrectly identifies the purchaser as Kubota North America Corporation. The actual purchaser, as I noted, is Kubota Tractor Corporation. They are a subsidiary of Kubota North America Corporation. So it doesn't change any of the elements of the deal, but something we wanted to correct for the record. So there's two agreements in front of you tonight. One is a purchase and sale agreement that will convey the 43.76 acre portion of the city's 96.23 acre parcel to Kubota. So that is the sale document. The agreed upon purchase price, as I stated, is $5,150,000, or approximately $2.70 per square foot. So a note on the purchase price, we have an appraisal dated September 1st, 2021. That appraisal values the property at $4,800,000 or $2.52 a square foot. From the city's perspective, this is certainly market value. It also exceeds appraised value, and that's what we strive for. Just a note, again, the city in 2014 paid approximately $1.8 million for this same 43-acre piece of property, or 94 cents a square foot. So the $270 per square foot purchase price is just a little under 3x of what you paid for the property back in 2014, or about 7 years ago. You're also approving tonight and authorizing the city manager to execute a public improvement agreement. What this does is it secures Kubota's obligation to construct certain required public improvements, offsite improvements as they're known, which are conditions of approval of the project, notably drainage improvements, Grant Line Road, some parts of that Grant Line Road project, sewer, water, and dry utilities. That's all spelled out in the public improvement agreement. Technically, they're separate agreements, but they are cross-referenced. We anticipate the purchase and sale agreement requires a 30-day close, but we're already working on closing on the assumption that you will approve this. We expect that will be closer to about a week. And as I noted, because of that and the fact that the grading permit is ready to go and everybody's ready to go, we expect construction to start within 1 to 2 weeks. And so the recommendation, again, is to adopt the resolution as modified by the green sheet. You have alternatives. You can not adopt the resolution authorizing the sale, or you can direct staff to modify the agreements prior to authorization. There is no further environmental review required for this project and the fiscal impact. So at closing, of course, the city will obtain the $5.15 million purchase price. We will deposit that in the city's economic development fund, and we will have that for future opportunities. And that concludes my presentation. I'd be glad to answer any questions you might have.
All right, thank you, Mr. Doan. At this time, I will go ahead and open up the public comment opportunity.
For our attendees in the Zoom environment, this would be the public comment opportunity on item 9.1 of the agenda. Mayor and council members, as was noted by Mr. Doan, there was just only the staff memo that was submitted prior, and that staff memo does request some adjustments to the resolution that's being requested by staff under the recommendation. But otherwise, no other public comments were received on item 9.1. And I do have a member of the public signing up to speak. If I could ask Mr. Doan if you can stop sharing your screen, so that way I can pull up the speaker timer.
I will do that if I can.
And I think for our speaker and
make my way to it.
I believe this is Ms. Rosales, but if you have a series of questions, what we ask is when you use your opportunity for public comment, you have the 3 minutes, but that's for you to ask any of your questions in regards to the item or the subject. So you'd want to take that opportunity when you do have your time for public comment to ask all the questions that you might have on the matter. And I'll pull up that speaker timer now.
Diana Rosales, you may go ahead. You have 3 minutes.
Yes, I will take my time as a resident of Elk Grove. Absolutely. And I think that I could speak for everybody else as a resident, because I'm a resident here and I am very happy to join the meeting to see what's going on in the city. I will just ask really quickly. I know that your presentations were very nice. I'm here as a citizen. Maybe in your proposal, you can ask Kubota to give a donation to the Special Needs Elk Grove School District in that proposal. I think that would be very appreciative, and it would be a motivation as well for the residents
for your project. It's in need. Things are being developed very well here and it's growing, but donations are always nice to include in proposals. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments, ma'am. Are there any other callers?
And I do not see any other raised hand features for item 9.1. That will conclude public comment under item 9.1.
All right, then I'm going to go ahead and close the public comment opportunity and open it up for council comments, questions. I'll just go down the list. We'll start off with council member Spees.
Thank you. I appreciate the presentation. I appreciate the expediency that the planning department has moved, has moved in getting this application moving forward. I'm in support of the project and happy to hear what everyone else has to say. But if somebody else wants to make the motion, that's fine. But if not, I'm happy to do it.
You can make the motion.
Sure, since I was called on first, I'll make that motion.
All right, excellent. So I'll move on to council member Hume.
Thank you, Mayor. I echo Councilmember Spees' comments relative to the expediency of staff and all the hard work that went into this. I think I made comments last time we heard the appeal of the Planning Commission's decision of how important this is as a catalyst for the economic development of non-residential uses down in that area. And I just, I'm excited that Kubota has chose to remain and expand in the region. I think it's a win for us. It's a win for the region. It's a win for California. Happy to support the project. And I will second Councilmember Spees' motion.
Excellent. We'll move on to Councilmember Soon.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'll echo what my two colleagues previously just mentioned. I'd just like to add that I appreciated Mr. Doan's accounting of the events over the last, since 2014, so nearly 7 years, or it actually is 7 years, August of 2014. Just to give the public an idea of how long it can take for things like this to come together. So also supportive of the project. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I, of course, also am in support, not to be redundant for my other council colleagues who have summed it up succinctly. I'm very excited about the jobs, the 125 or so jobs that were listed, and then, of course, the 400 or so construction jobs. Given that we're still dealing with economic recovery, this is excellent. And proud to say that my understanding, the majority of those are union jobs. So that's also welcome and great news for working families. But again, this location and jump starting our industrial annexation land and what it means, letting people know that Elk Grove is open for business, and just real proud to welcome a multinational company here into our city. So I enthusiastically support this and welcome to Elk Grove. So we do have a motion and a second on the floor.
And from the staff perspective, I just want to confirm with our motioner Spees and seconder Hume that is for the motion as amended by the staff green sheet memo that adds some updates to the resolution.
That is correct.
Excellent. So with that, I will proceed with the roll call vote for the amended resolution of item 9.1, starting with Councilmember Spees.
Aye.
Councilmember Hume.
Aye.
Councilmember Suen.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Nguyen is absent, and Mayor Singh Allen.
Aye.
That amended resolution of item 9.1 will pass 4-0.
Thank you so much. We will go on to our next item.
We'll take us on to item 9.2, which is to consider a resolution establishing the American Rescue Plan Act nonprofit grant program and adopting the ARPA nonprofit grant program guidelines.
Good evening, Mayor and Council members. I am Alicia Tutt, your Housing and Grant Specialist. The item I have before you tonight is the American Rescue Plan Act, or ARPA, nonprofit grant program. At the August 11th meeting, the Council approved a total of $2.5 million of ARPA funding to be made available as grants to nonprofits. that have faced economic hardship resulting from or exacerbated by the COVID-19 public health emergency. We have created a set of guidelines, which we are asking you to approve tonight, to distribute those funds in the amounts between $5,000 and $350,000 per nonprofit. We have some eligibility criteria for nonprofits, some of which they must have programming that serves or benefits Elk Grove residents or businesses. They need to be an IRS tax-exempt nonprofit and in good standing with the Secretary of State and California Attorney General's Registry of Charitable Trusts if required to be by law. They need to meet city insurance requirements, and they will have to demonstrate financial impacts directly related to the COVID-19 pandemic. We are recommending that there be no exclusions of eligibility based on previous COVID-19 funding assistance, so long as the expenses are not duplicated with prior funding. Some of the eligible costs under this grant program would be coverage of loss of earnings, decline in revenues, or impacts of canceled fundraising events during periods of closure or limited operation due to COVID-19 public health orders, costs associated with implementation of prevention or mitigation measures to contain the spread of the virus, such as physical changes to enable social distancing, enhanced cleaning efforts, barriers or partitions, or COVID-19 vaccination testing or contact tracing programs. Reimbursement of expenses related to the organization's response to the COVID-19 public health emergency, or funding for new programs designed in response to the pandemic, or those designed to serve a population disparately impacted by public health emergency and its economic impact, such as lower income households. We anticipate releasing the online application this Friday, September 10th, with a closing deadline of October 3rd. The staff will be available throughout the application period to answer questions and provide technical assistance as needed. And we will be working with public affairs and doing some outreach through our extensive list of nonprofit organizations who have been identified previously an interest in city funding to advertise the grant opportunity. Applications will be reviewed by staff for eligibility and completeness, and we will work with a review panel comprised of citizens that will make recommendations to the council on what to fund. We expect to bring the recommendations back to council in early November. And with that, I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have.
All right, thank you for that excellent presentation. I will go ahead and open up the public comment opportunity.
For members in the Zoom attendee audience, this would be the opportunity to use the raise hand function for public comment on item 9.2. Mayor and council members, there were no written comments that were submitted prior to the meeting in relation to item 9.2. I'm reviewing over our list of attendees to see if anyone wants to use that raise hand function. There are none, and that will conclude public comment opportunities on item 9.2.
All right, thank you. I will go ahead and close the public comment opportunity and open it up for any council comments or questions. I see council member Hume's camera off, so I think he's ready to go.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd just like to quickly say that I encourage anybody who is involved with a nonprofit or utilizes a nonprofit to encourage them to apply as long as they meet the standards of this. You know, these COVID relief funds really can pass through us as a local government. And, you know, as an agency, we fared better than expected. And I know that that isn't the case for a lot of the boots on the ground really doing the heavy lifting. And so please take advantage of this hopefully once in a lifetime opportunity.
Is that a motion in there somewhere?
And I'll move the item.
We'll go on to council member Soon.
Thank you, Mayor. Yeah, I just wanted to take the opportunity to second everything that was just said by council member. So please apply, everybody. Thank you.
And council member Spees, did you want to add on anything?
Sure, I'll align myself with the comments of the previous council members. I think it's a great program. And since I don't believe that Councilman Soon gave a second, I'll just have to do that.
I think he did.
I seconded.
Did you?
Yeah.
Oh, all right. Well, I thought I got it one up on you, but all right. I'm ready to vote.
You can have
Well, I thank you for the presentation. Great work. And I do also hope it's a once in a lifetime, because we don't want to have to go through this again. And how we are going to be dispersing the funds is exactly how Congress intended. And so when it was signed into law, so this is again to help all of those local nonprofits that went above and beyond. And not only were they impacted, but they also continue to provide services to our community, which is, of course, you know, without that partnership, it would have been even more challenging. Just a quick question, Ms. Tutt, is you mentioned that there's going to be a panel that will be reviewing the applications. Is this a citizens panel? Is it mixed with city staff and other, like, who's on this panel?
The panel has not been created yet. Last time when we did the CARES grant, I think we received recommendations of citizens from council that were a part of that. So we anticipate using a similar process.
Okay, excellent. Thank you. And I would invite our, even the task force that a number of us are on that are, I think, on our attendee list, myself and council member Soon. It's a very diverse group of people that are already in place as an added tool if you needed to use that. So, but thank you. I'm in strong support. So we have a motion and a second, Mr. Clerk.
That will move towards the roll call vote for the resolution of item 9.2, starting with council member Spees.
Aye.
Council member Hume.
Aye.
Council member Soon.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Nguyen is absent, and Mayor Singh Allen.
Aye.
Resolution of item 9.2 will pass 4-0. That will take us on to item 9.3, which is to consider a resolution establishing the City of Elk Grove 2021 COVID-19 Business Recovery Grant Program and adopting the program policies, procedures, and guidelines.
All right, welcome, Ms. Brown.
Welcome, thank you. Yeah, let me see if I can share my screen properly here. Okay, this will be our item. Could everyone see the presentation?
You have the presentation pulled up. If you want to move it into slideshow mode,
yep.
Right now it's kind of in the design mode.
Perfect. All right, I'm Rachel Brown, the Economic Development Manager, and similar to the prior item, I'm going to talk about a COVID recovery plan. In this case, it'll be for our businesses, our for-profit entities. Oops, sorry. So the recommended action tonight is to adopt a resolution establishing the City of Elk Grove 2021 COVID-19 Business Recovery Grant Program and adopting the program policies, procedures, and guidelines. I'm gonna do a little background. Alicia kind of touched on a few of the items that last year we did receive some CARES Act funding in July 2020, and council gave direction on how that money was to be spent. The next month, August 2020, City Council established the COVID-19 Small Business Program. For the rest of my presentation, I will refer to that as the 2020 program. We did receive $750,000 for that program to run it. We ran two rounds. Each were 1 week application periods. At the conclusion of both rounds, we awarded 111 grants, totaling $437,500. I did want to mention that we did not exhaust the funds. The CARES Act money had some strings attached and a deadline to spend the money. We ran this program last fall. We're kind of running out of time to do subsequent rounds. Moving on to this funding source, March of this year, President Biden signed the American Rescue Plan Act, and it allows for us to create programs to support businesses. And in August of this year, Elk Grove City Council adopted a budget allocating sources to a number of different programs. For my item tonight, if $4 million was allocated in fiscal year 21-22 to assist businesses negatively impacted by COVID. Got some kind of technicalities here, but we evaluated the 2020 grant program to determine what worked, what didn't. We made some modifications, which are outlined in the staff report. I'll try to highlight a few key items here. One of the challenges I think we created, just not knowing any better last year, was we had an eligibility requirement that you could not have received other sources of funding. I think that was quite limiting. So we removed that from the 2021 program that is before you tonight. We also expanded the review period on the 2020 program. We only reviewed about 3 months year over year. And so for the 2021 program, we're suggesting a 12-month review period. So we have, it'll be easier to collect business taxes, I think. And so that'll be a good document to use for verification of a revenue loss. We're also gonna extend the application period. We don't have similar tight deadlines in terms of federal requirements to spend the money in a short amount of time. So I think we'll take advantage of that. Instead of a 1 week application period, we plan to do at least a 30-day application period. And if in one round we don't exhaust the funds, I suppose that we'd probably do multiple rounds to make sure we get that money out, given that we don't have a similar date deadline. With this 2021 program, we actually created a list of targeted industries. There's a lot of reasons why these landed on the list, but a lot of them throughout the last year, 18 months of the different closures mandated by the state and or county, a lot of these industries were pretty hard hit without people being able to gather in close spaces. So that's how we identified hospitality, restaurants, entertainment, personal services, and daycares. So in order to figure out how the $4 million should be categorized in terms of what money will be available for what business types, I looked at 18-month period worth of business license data for Elk Grove businesses. That equals about 4,400. And we found that about a third of those self-identified as home-based businesses. And of those remaining, took the time to review 900 different line items to make sure and categorize to get a sense for which might be target industries versus other small businesses. And we, it looks like about 40% of those would fall under the target industries as I outlined on the previous slide. So given that information, you kind of have a summary table here. I used for this fourth column in 2020 average grant amount in order to just kind of some rough numbers, how much money went to which business types and how we could allocate. So given this information, I guess the crux of the matter is on the next slide, which is how we plan to allocate the money for this program. 10% would be allocated to home-based, which equals $400,000. Non-targeted small businesses will get 30% of the 4 million, which is 1.2 million. Target businesses will get a larger chunk of the allocated funds, 2.4 million. And that's in total. The program as drafted in the staff report has the grant amounts here, $500 for home base, a flat rate. It won't be a range. Non-target small businesses, we were using a similar metric like we did last year in the 2020 program, which is FTE, full-time equivalent employees. So we had kind of a low end and a high end. If there was one FTE, you'd get 800. Whereas if you had 20 full-time employees, you'd get 16,000 in this category. And then for targeted, we upped it a little bit per FTE to 1250. So the lowest grant amount would be 1250. The maximum would be 25,000. A lot of the eligibility criteria is the same as 2020 program. You gotta be located in Elk Grove, of course, to receive our funds, have a business license. Our business license process is pretty easy. So if someone didn't have a business license, it's pretty easy to get within a couple of days. I don't see that as being a huge hurdle. We had to kind of pick a date to figure how to evaluate. We kind of supposed that March 1st, 2020 was maybe the early stages or right at the beginning of the pandemic. So we figure if you're in business at that time and you stuck it out one way or another all of these last 18 months and you want to remain open, you'd be an eligible business. As I mentioned earlier, we want to see a revenue loss for the year 2020 compared to 2019. 2019, I suppose, would be kind of a great year for most. That was a pre-pandemic year of the full calendar year of 2019. Good standing with the city and all the city, state, federal laws. Business should be in good standing. We separated the targeted businesses and the non-targeted in this metric here of this 3 million. So for home base and non-targeted, 3 million gross annual revenue. For targeted, we'd made an allowance for them to have more than 20 full-time equivalent employees. And I mentioned the eligible types, but a quick recap here at the bottom: hospitality, entertainment, restaurants, personal services, those are the ones in the targeted categories. The funds can be used for a lot of different things, general business operations, payroll, payments to suppliers, rent payments, PPE. It seems like there's still a need for folks to have gloves, hand sanitizer, masks, and things like that. So definitely an eligible cost or way to spend the money. And as I mentioned earlier, we'd have a 30-day online application period. We also will supply paper versions. I understand that everyone may not have access to a computer or the internet, so we will certainly make paper-based applications available. And we're going to provide assistance in key languages via phone, in person, and virtual meetings to try to make our best effort to assist all interested applicants. The other thing different, we were kind of on such a tight turnaround for 2020, we didn't do a lot of pre-outreach in advance of the program. So we do intend to do a much more robust effort and outreach this time. We intend to do pre-outreach, like I said, in advance of the program going live. So tonight I do not have an identified date of a go live for the application for our first round, but we will try to widely publicize the program. In addition to our typical channels, we're going to do a much wider focus. Given that some people may not have access to internet and computers, we're going to have a booth at the Neighborhood Market for a few consecutive weeks. We're going to do a direct mailer to businesses for which a city has contact information. We did not do that last time. We will translate the mailer into a few key languages so that hopefully we'll be able to reach a greater number of businesses that way. We'll obviously continue to lean on our business and economic partner organizations. This is not necessarily exhaustive, but this is kind of the outreach plan in broad terms. And just want to highlight that we're going to try as best we can to get the word out using all efforts that we can. So after the agenda posted last Friday, we actually, the mayor's economic task force convened for a meeting yesterday to have a quick discussion on outreach efforts for the program and the methodology of how the grants were formulated in the program as written in the staff report was they had a recommendation for an alternative. So this table represents the alternative grant calculation methodology. I'll highlight a few quick things. The allocation by category here, 10% for home base, 60 for target, and 30% for other small, is exactly the same as I had just described in the original version of the program. So the funds available for those business types remain the same. The major difference is we converted from FTE, the full-time employee equivalent calculation, to 2019 annual business revenue. And so these are the tiers from the California Relief Grant. We just took that as one way to create the tiers. And so with this estimated tier category, the grants would be as follows here. Target businesses, the grants would range from 5,000 to 15. And for other small businesses, 3,500 to 10,500. Main difference is the low-end grant on this program, this alternative, is higher. And the high-end grant is lower than the other program. So whereas the max grant amount was $25,000 for a target business in the previous alternative, in this alternative it would be $15,000. I could do this line for line, but just to kind of do a quick glance there. We can come back to this if needed during the discussion component. Recommended and alternative actions, council could adopt the resolution as presented in the staff report. Could adopt the resolution with this alternative funding approach that I just touched on, or not establish the program. In terms of funding, fiscal impact, As I mentioned earlier, we got the funds from federal government, and City Council has received the funds already, and so we have the $4 million available to spend, and it would not have further impact on the city's budget. And that does conclude my presentation. I imagine there might be some questions, so I'll be happy to answer those.
All right, thank you for your presentation. I will go ahead and open up the public comment opportunity.
Looks like we have a few folks that are already using that raise hand function, but this would be that public comment opportunity for item 9.3. I would just ask staff if they can stop the share screen on their side so that I can pull up the speaker timer here soon. But Mayor and council members, there were no written comments that were previously submitted for item 9.3. We do have a few folks that are signing up to speak, so I will pull up that speaker timer now.
Angela Perry, you may go ahead. You have 3 minutes.
Thank you. Good evening, Mayor Singh Allen and council members. I'm Angela Perry, Elk Grove Chamber of Commerce and co-chair of the Recovery Task Force. First, I'd like to commend the staff on the previous item 9.2 for nonprofit grant program. Very well done, as well as the Economic Development Department, specifically Rachel Brown on her work on this item. As Rachel mentioned, the task force met yesterday to discuss the best methods for outreach for the grant program, but members had concerns about the program as originally presented. They felt strongly that the original measure of award by full-time equivalent employees may not be fair to many business owners. Discussion was had about cultural groups who, in large part, are single owner employee run or family-run businesses whose staff is made up of family members who are not necessarily official employees. The task force felt that the base amount was far too low for businesses falling in those categories, as well as others, including businesses whose staff is comprised of independent contractors, such as salons. Some other models were discussed, and task force members were all in agreement that a measure by net revenue is far more equitable and inclusive. We believe that the alternate provided offers the best positive impact to the business community. I would also like to thank my co-chair, Angela Spies, Mayor Singh Allen, and all of the task force members for their work over the last several months. So I'm happy to answer any questions you might have. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Perry. We'll go on to our next caller.
Selena Pryor, you may go ahead. You have 3 minutes.
Good evening, and thank you for this time to give my public comment on this item. I want to thank Mayor Bobby Singh Allen and the council members for just considering the plight of small business owners. I am the president of the Black Small Business Association of California. We started during the pandemic, and we have been servicing small businesses, particularly micro businesses, who have been very hard hit by the pandemic. And so it's very encouraging to see that the city of Elk Grove wants to do something to help in something purposeful and intentional and meaningful that will go a long way in helping our small business owners. I am very supportive of the alternative approach. I think using income as opposed to FTEs is a far better has a far better outcome for our micro business owners. And with that, I'm very supportive of this proposal. Thank you.
Thank you so much for calling in. We'll go to our next caller.
John Wallace, you may go ahead. You have 3 minutes.
Thank you. Mayor Singh Allen and council, good evening, and thank you for your consideration on this item. As part of the task force, we've had some wonderful people. We've had some great suggestions. We've had some good additions. I'm going to join the others in fully supporting the alternative method of calculating the award based on business revenue rather than FTEs. I think this is fair. I think it reflects actual losses that cannot be reflected with FTEs, and I would encourage the council to approve this item. Thank you so much again.
Thank you for calling in, sir. Any other callers?
And I think that concludes our attendees wishing to use the raise hand function on item 9.3. That'll conclude public comment on item 9.3.
All right, then I will go ahead and close the public comment opportunity. I see a few hands raised. Before I go on to my council colleagues, Ms. Brown, if I can ask you a quick question, and then I'll go through deliberations and Q&A with colleagues. So the previous slide and presentation, that was pre-meeting, obviously. So now, since we've had those robust discussions yesterday and then what may come this evening, in terms of managing the applications, do you believe that the alternative is very easy to manage and perhaps maybe even easier than the FTE application process?
Certainly, yeah. Thank you for asking the question. Staff is prepared to go either direction, whatever council prefers, and we'd have no additional difficulty administering the program with this revision.
Okay, very good. I'll save my questions and comments for the end. I will start with Council Member Hume.
Thank you, Mayor. I actually had my hand raised to ask about that, the item that came out of the task force discussion, but I just want to thank Rachel Brown and our staff, as well as your task force, for being so thoughtful and deliberate in clarification and revision to the programs, kind of keeping what worked and changing out maybe what could be done better. And I really appreciate the clarification from the callers with respect to the moving to the income as opposed to FTEs as a determinant. And it really looks at those folks who, as it said, might be a family owned or single proprietor situation, but they're grinding and they're trying to survive. And so, like the last item relative to the nonprofits, you know, this this really is a situation where we're passing these monies through and really trying to help those who have been most hit by the economic impacts of this pandemic.
Thank you, sir. I saw Council Member Soon. Did you move it? I'm sorry.
I did move it, and I'm trying to turn everything off here, but my screen is froze up. So
are you moving the alternative?
Yes.
Okay, just for clarification. All right, I will go on to Council Member Spees. His hand is raised.
Yeah, so first I wanted to thank the task force. I know that it's been an iterative process for a number of months, and I appreciate your dedication to seeing that through. And of course, I want to be very sure to say thank you to Ms. Brown, because you know, a lot of times when you get a staff package together, you think you got everything nailed down. To have it modified quickly towards the end can be a little bit challenging. You rose to the challenge. I think it's great. I'm happy to support the alternative, and I'm looking forward to again a sad situation, hopefully being a little bit helpful to the business community. So. Since I guess I beat Darren this time, I'll second.
Council Member Soon, any additional comments or questions?
I just wanted to give that one to Kevin because I took the last one. No, I want to kudos to all the task force. Full disclosure, I was not able to attend that last meeting given conflicts. So I'm glad to see what came forward and pleased to hear the testimonies from the members. But I did want to quickly thank Rachel and Alicia on the nonprofit grant side too for all their hard work in putting this together. And especially, you know, Rachel, 4,000 businesses to review is no easy feat. So again, thank you very much to all your hard work and hope to get some of these funds out distributed to applicants as soon as possible. Thank you.
Thank you. And I echo the same comments as, you know, someone who believed in having a task force to focus solely on economic recovery. I just want to thank everybody. We have such a diverse and dynamic group of individuals. And our newest member, welcoming Ms. Selena Pryor with the Black Small Business Association of California. You know, it's having that extra insight from different industries that really helps all of us in our decision-making model and in our process. And we want to do data-driven decisions to reinforce what we're doing. And I'm just so pleased, because one of the problems with the last round of when we had the CARES funding allocations, the biggest complaint was small businesses not knowing that they even existed. So we've developed a very robust plan under the leadership of Ms. Brown. You've done a tremendous job, and I commend you from not only hosting a pre-meeting last week, but then subsequently our task force meeting yesterday, and then going back and doing your own homework and updating those tables and revisions to see what that would actually look like and see if that was the viable option. So being able to be fluid and flexible in real time, I sincerely appreciate it. And I know so many of our small businesses who will benefit from this also appreciate it. And you, of course, are also a member of the task force. So thanking you for your continued leadership in serving our community. And I'm also really pleased to see that our targeted industries that suffered the most, given some of the limitations that were placed on them, that we are also taking a look at that. So just wanting to thank everyone that has served on the task force. It's a standing ad hoc committee. So if ever, we need to examine anything related to COVID economic recovery, but you also have a standing group of great folks that are willing, able to volunteer and provide invaluable input. Again, thank you everyone, but thank you also Rachel for updating all of the information in preparation for this evening. We have a motion and a second for the alternative model.
Now, just take a brief moment just to touch base with staff that they have everything they need for that alternative model, which I believe is that measure by net revenue.
I see a hand raise. I don't know if it's from before, but the public comment is over.
The hand raise function was put down, but I think it's just they also might be just wanting to hear that clarification of what the amended motion for sounds like the alternative is the measure by net revenue. And if that's correct, I'm looking to staff.
Yes.
Yeah, Jason.
All right.
That's correct.
If you've got everything you need, then I will move forward with that roll call vote on the alternative motion for item 9.3, starting with Councilmember Spees.
Aye.
Councilmember Hume.
Aye.
Councilmember Suen.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Nguyen is absent, and Mayor Singh Allen.
Enthusiastic aye.
And that resolution of item 9.3 with that alternative will pass 4-0.
All right. Thank you, everyone. Great work. We will move on to our next item.
And that next item is 9.4, which is to consider a resolution approving a conditional loan commitment of $6 million for the proposed Lila Affordable Housing Project.
Good evening, Mayor and Council Members. I'm Sarah Bontrager, your Housing and Public Services Manager. I will share my presentation here. Let me get that up. So we're here tonight to talk about the Lila apartment complex and making a loan commitment to that. So just by way of background, what the funding source we would be using to make this loan commitment is our Affordable Housing Fund. That fund is generated by new market rate development, both residential and non-residential development. We can use the Affordable Housing Fund for a variety of things. Historically, we have put most of the funding into new apartment construction, but we can also use the fund for down payment assistance to acquire and rehabilitate housing, to acquire land, or for other special projects as designated by the City Council. Since incorporation, the city has funded 14 projects and about 1,800 affordable housing units. Earlier this year, we released a two-phased RFP process. Under the first phase, we were looking for 9% tax credit projects. And some months ago, the council approved a loan commitment to the Villages at Bilby project, which has submitted an application for its other financing. Under the second phase of the RFP, we had 7 proposals, which is more than we've ever received before. And the Affordable Housing Committee ultimately asked for loan applications from two of those projects. One is the Lila, which we're discussing tonight. The other is Cornerstone Village, which you will see in the future. Due to their funding timeframes, they had a later deadline. And so we are still working with them on finalizing some of the details of that project and the loan terms for that project. And so you'll likely see that come before the council in October. But the Lila project was one of two projects. It is the bigger of the two. It is 294 units, a family apartment complex. This would be the biggest affordable housing project that we have in the city. The next largest is the 222 unit project. That's the Seasons Senior Housing. This would also be different in some other ways from our other affordable housing projects in terms of the unit sizes and the unit affordability levels. As you can see, this project includes some studio units, and those we do not have in any of our other projects in the city. So that would be a new unit size for us. And then you'll also notice that this project has units that are at the 80% of area median income level. So about 58 of its units are at that level. That is an income level that we have not historically seen in our affordable housing. Typically, the units max out at 60% of the area median income. And so these units would be available to families who have relatively few options for affordable housing within the city, but who may still not be able to afford market rate apartments. So here you can see a rendering of the Lila's architectural design. The project does have many amenities that are fairly standard for affordable housing in our community. It has a community room with fitness equipment and computers. It will have a swimming pool and a children's play area. And it will also offer a minimum of 15 hours per week of on-site social services, including up to 10 hours a week of after-school programming. So here you can see the location of the project. It's along Bruceville, between Bighorn Boulevard and Laguna Boulevard. The project combines six parcels. It's near the Walgreens there, and there's a car wash existing. Amenities-wise, it's very near the Laguna Community Park is just north up there. The Harriet Eddy Middle School is a little bit south. You can see the track for the school in the photo there. And the Target Shopping Center is right across Bruceville Road. To the north there, you can see there's some multifamily housing. That is a market rate apartment complex, Bella Vista Apartments. So here you see the site plan. The developer has tried to shield the units from the commercial uses using a tree canopy. It has a good amount of open park space. You can see kind of in the middle of some of the units there, it's labeled linear park. And then there's some additional park and plaza space around the swimming pool and a playground there that's to the left of the pool in this site plan. Overall, the Lila project is fairly expensive, looking at a total cost of about $104 million per unit. That works out to be about $353,000. However, the city subsidy requested is relatively low. At this point, we're at a little under $21,000, or about 6% of the cost per unit. The developer is proposing to fund the project with tax credits. This would be a 4% tax credit project and tax exempt bonds on the project. And that's the majority of the funding on it. They're also looking at a deferred developer fee, which is basically taking a portion of the developer fee to which they're allowed under the regulations and spreading that out over up to 15 years to be repaid. And then also looking at a city loan request of $6 million. So after the Affordable Housing Committee reviewed the seven proposals that we received, they requested loan applications from two of the projects, the Lila being one. The loan application provides more information needed to assess the project and its risks. That includes some of the development team's qualifications, a 30-year project pro forma so that we can study what assumptions are being made regarding rents and expenses, and how the financials will play out over time, and how the city's loan will be repaid, and a preliminary market study so that we can ensure that there will be adequate demand for the units over the life of the project. Once we get the loan application, staff reviews it, and then we take it forward to the Affordable Housing Committee, which is comprised of two council members, Council Member Suen and Council Member Hume. So when we looked at the Lila, it has a number of strengths. For one thing, the development team is quite experienced. The Pacific Companies, the developer, owns over 100 projects, including three in Elk Grove, Avery Gardens, Bow Street, and the Gardens at Quail Run. They have two projects pending. They're doing a second phase of Gardens at Quail Run without city funding. That will be an affordable housing project. And then they are also the developer of Villages at Bilby, which was chosen in phase one of this RFP process. And if awarded, that's a 126 unit project over two phases. And they are currently applying for financing for that project. They also have a nonprofit partner that has provided services to other city projects. So a team that's worked together before and worked together specifically in Elk Grove before. The project location is really a strong location, easy access to transit and services. It's very near shopping. The pharmacy, there's the Walgreens on the corner, and the Target also has a pharmacy. And it has easy access to the Laguna Community Park and Wackford Center. As I mentioned earlier, the unit affordability and size mix is something that would be new for the city. So that's not without some risk, because we don't really know what the exact demand is, but we anticipate that that there would be adequate demand for all of the unit sizes. The financials on the project look solid. It looks like the developer will be able to meet the commitments that they're making in terms of what they've projected on their pro forma. And they will have on-site property management. And while we typically see one property management unit for most of our affordable housing complexes, in this case, because of the size of the project, they will have three property manager units to be occupied by the overall property manager, the maintenance supervisor, and then either an assistant property manager or a maintenance staff person. So as is common when we look at projects, we did identify some weaknesses with this project. One of them is that the developer fee significantly exceeds the city's standards. The city typically allows for up to a 10% developer fee on projects. That is less than what is allowed by the tax credit funding agencies. But our standard is 10%. So there are some mitigating factors there, which I'll discuss in the next slide. The operating expenses in this case are assumed to rise faster than the rents. The developer's projection shows the rents rising at 2.5% a year, while the operating expenses are rising at 3.5% a year. So eventually there could be a situation where the property would not have enough funding coming in from rents to pay its operating expenses. When we looked at the unit, the new unit size of studios, although we don't think that this will be a challenge right now because of the incredible level of demand for affordable housing in our community, we do recognize that in a softer rental market, a market like we saw in say like 2011, 2012 during the foreclosure crisis, smaller units were harder to rent. Many people who were in good shape and renting units would prefer a larger unit. And so So those could be more difficult to rent if we ended up in another recession, say. Staff also had some concerns about the services budget on the project. It is not increased proportionately from what we have seen on our other projects. Looking at that, there may be more money needed to provide a high quality services to this project over time. And the developer felt that in conversation with their nonprofit service provider that they could, using this budget, still provide a high level of services. But calling that out as, you know, as something we would want to look at and monitor over time. So, and again, this next concern is very common with these projects, but the replacement reserve deposit, it's about $250 per unit per year. That's absolutely not adequate to maintain the project over 55 years. So we do expect that that the project would at some point need to be recapitalized to make major improvements. Typically that happens around year 15 to year 20. The annual loan repayments that are projected, especially in the early years of this, are small, and the loan is not amortizing. So there will not be a situation where all of the interest on the loan is paid fully. So some of the factors that mitigate the project weaknesses. So many of the project weaknesses are not really uncommon for these sorts of transactions. The affordable housing, it's common for rent projections to be less than operating expense projections. And there are ways that developers can make up for that, such as by having a lower than expected vacancy rate. This project, for example, has projected a 5% vacancy rate, but what we're seeing in our affordable housing at this point is 0% vacancy rates. So there's an opportunity to make up some ground there. We also, in regards to the developer fee specifically, did negotiate with the developer a payment structure that prioritizes the city's loan payments after the 10% developer fee is reached. And so once the developer has reached that 10% mark, typically what's left in the project budget, the residual receipts we call it, is split 50% between the city and 50% between the developer. So once that 10% developer fee is reached, the rest of any deferred developer fee will need to be paid out of the developer's 50% of residual receipts. So it won't affect the city's loan payments. We do have a really strong housing market right now and solid demand for units of all sizes. I'm sure you've heard me say before, but I'll remind you again, the level of demand that we saw when we opened the gardens at Quail Run and did a lottery for that, 96 units, and we received 28,000 unique lottery entries. And so we feel confident that the units sizes and income levels will all have adequate demand. And of course, when we're looking at these loans, our goal is to provide gap financing. If the project was showing a significant profit, then they wouldn't need city funds to build it. And so we recognize that that most projects, most affordable housing is going to need some amount of city financing in order to come to fruition. And in return for making this loan, the developer is committed to making units affordable for 55 years. And they've also committed to working with the city to help us to address homelessness by moving households experiencing homelessness to the top of the wait list for any units for which they are qualified. Once we reviewed the loan application, we moved forward with developing a loan term sheet. The loan term sheet you'll see is attached to the resolution in your packet tonight. It summarizes the key aspects of the loan, and we use it in preparing the loan documents if the developer is able to secure the additional funding that they need to bring the project to fruition. So in this case, that would be tax credit, 4% tax credit and tax-exempt bond financing. It also just clarifies going into this, the expectations for the developer and the senior lender. So that the senior lender who hasn't been chosen yet typically is aware of what the developer and the city agreed to initially. And so staff and the Affordable Housing Committee and the developer all worked to negotiate the loan terms that you see in your packet tonight. Those loan terms include a loan amount of $6 million. The ultimate loan amount could be less than $6 million. Initially, the developer had applied for $4 million, but a council decision after the RFP was, after their proposal was submitted, meant that there was a new parkland fee that would be charged for this project, which the developer estimated in coordination with the Kasumnas Community Services District at $2 million. And so staff, in looking at that, the fee is based on some factors that are currently unknown. And so we feel that the fee could be less than $2 million. And so what we've negotiated is that either the loan amount would be reduced if there are savings on that parkland fee, or the developer would make a principal payment on the loan in the amount of the savings on the parkland fee. So ultimately, we're hoping that the loan amount will be something less than $6 million. The loan has an interest rate of 4%, a term of 37 years, and the city's annual payment would be 50% of the residual cash flow. So the residual cash flow is what is left after the property accounts for its operating expenses, its payments on its tax-exempt bonds, some payments to the developer, and typically the deferred developer fee. As I noted earlier, the deferred developer fee will not be taken out of the residual cash flow calculation until after, once the developer reaches that 10% of the developer fee in total. We have a standard disbursement schedule that we've used on many projects tied to framing completion, the completion of construction, and issuance of temporary and final certificates of occupancy, and to the project stabilization and cost certification. And of course, our requirement that the units be deed restricted for 55 years. So we also include in the loan terms a requirement to complete annual income reviews and adjust affordability accordingly. And that is really nice on a project like this that has units at so many different income levels, including 80%. So ideally, as people live in affordable housing, if their income increases over time, then they could be moved to a higher income level unit and their rent would be adjusted, thus freeing up the unit at a lower income level for a household who needed that more. We also want to see public bidding of trades and subtrades. We have some guarantees related to the project completion and replacement reserve deposits and what is termed bad acts on the developer's part. Fortunately, on our past projects, we've never had these things occur, but we include the guarantees to protect the city nevertheless. And we will require a capital needs assessment upon transfer to make sure that the property's long-term maintenance needs are met. So the Affordable Housing Committee met on August 30th and reviewed the loan and the proposed terms, and they recommended that the council approve a conditional loan commitment consistent with the draft term sheet provided tonight. And so the council has some options, which is the first of which is approving the conditional loan commitment. This would allow the developer to file their application for tax credits tomorrow. And then they have a couple subsequent rounds if they aren't awarded in those rounds. The council also has the opportunity to request continued negotiations, in which case staff would engage in those and bring the loan commitment forward to council at a later date. Or of course, the council could deny the loan. So again, the committee's recommendation was to approve the conditional loan commitment. So that concludes my presentation, and I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have.
All right, thank you, Ms. Bontrager, for your report. I will go ahead and open up the public comment opportunity.
And for our attendees in the Zoom environment, this would be that opportunity to speak for general public comment on item 9.4 using that raise hand feature. Mayor and council members, there were no written comments that were submitted prior to the council meeting on item 9.4. Taking my attention over to the list of attendees in our Zoom environment, I do not see any raised hand functions. That's going to conclude public comment under item 9.4. I do have someone who wanted to jump in after I was concluding that there was no comment. I'll pull up that speaker timer now.
Mike Kelly, you may go ahead. You have 3 minutes.
I wasn't sure if there's going to be an opportunity to speak for the developer. I just wanted to chime in quickly if I can. I don't know if this is the right forum for that. Is this appropriate time for the developer to speak? Okay. Okay, awesome. Thanks. So hello everybody. I'm Mike Kelly. I'm with the Pacific Companies, and I don't have a prepared presentation other than say, I'd like to thank the Affordable Housing Committee and staff for the time and effort taken to review the project and the term sheet you have before you tonight. I'd also like to thank Sarah for the presentation she just provided. It's thorough and it's accurate. Just to share, you know, a couple more virtues of the proposal that you have in front of you. I'd say, you know, but for a project back in 2003, you know, this project has the lowest per unit subsidy in the history of the city. You know, when you contemplate the initial $4 million we requested and exclude the additional funds needed to address the new parkland fee that was attached to the project. Just, you know, as an aside, back then the construction costs were probably a third of what they are now. And also, you know, this project has the lowest percentage of the city's contribution in relation to the total development cost in the history of the city. You know, as Sarah indicated, the costs are estimated to be just over $100 million. So all of this is, you know, is being made possible to the city at a time when construction costs are unequivocally the highest in the history of the city. You know, also like to add that, you know, the project does provide housing for a wide spectrum of Elk Grove residents at various income levels, you know, ranging from 30% of the area median income up to 80% of the area median income. One request I do have is if this item is indeed approved this evening, we'd ask that staff commit to providing the loan commitment letter and resolution to us via email tomorrow by 11 o'clock, if that's possible, because the application is due tomorrow to the state and the letter needs to be reviewed and incorporated by the bond issuer in time to submit to CIDLAC. And that is the completion of my comments, and I'm happy to address any questions you may have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kelly. Any other speakers?
And review of the attendee list in the Zoom environment. I do not see any other raised hand functions. That will conclude public comment on item 9.4.
All right, thank you. I'll go ahead and close the public comment opportunity and open it up for council comments and direction. I would love to hear if there's any additional comments from our Affordable Housing Committee members. So I will start with council members soon.
Thank you, Mayor. First, I want to thank Sarah for her hard work. These projects are very complex and required a great deal of analysis and frankly, negotiation on her part. So I just want to thank her for all their efforts in bringing this together. And in the short time frame, just to elaborate a bit, you know, Mr. Kelly mentioned the letter by 11 a.m. tomorrow, and I would, if this goes forward, I certainly would request staff to make that happen. But part of this consideration was the opportunity for the applicant to compete in this next round of funding. This next round of funding, first of all, is one more opportunity that the city could take to obtain funds from the TCAC committee, the Tax Credit Allocation Committee, but also the certain guidelines in this particular round specific to high resource areas, which this site is a part of. And there's no guarantee whether those guidelines stay the same, so they change. So what may be competitive one year may not be competitive in other years. And so that's one of the motivations also behind enabling these folks to go forward. Also, they were furthest along. And I wanted to, the two projects that we move forward, I wanted to highlight these two projects, the Bethesda project and this one, the Lila, serve two unique demographics. And that was another reason why the committee felt both of these were of equal value and was looking for a way to move both of them forward. Unfortunately, as was mentioned earlier in the staff presentation, the decision by our council, by all of us, to close a loophole that only affected this one project resulted in a cost, significant cost, something that anyone who is pro business would appreciate is adding a significant cost, you know, in the neighborhood of $2 million after things are so far along is it's difficult for any business to take on that cost. So I'm glad that we found a way forward on this. I hope and I ask for my colleagues' approval this evening. With that, I'll move the item. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Councilmember Hume.
Thank you, Mayor. Councilmember Soon gave a lot of good factual, detailed background information, so I'll keep my comments fairly short here. And I want to start just by saying that I don't think that sufficient public praise can be heaped upon Sarah Bontrager for the work that she does relative to the Affordable Housing Committee. She came to us with asking whether or not we wanted to do X or Y, and we said yes. And she went back and made it happen. And so that was an exhaustive effort that I'm sure to winnow it down to projects that she could bring forward in good faith, and then to even go above and beyond when we said, well, we want to fund more than one project. And so Councilmember Soon is correct in that the Bethesda project that will be coming forward for council at a future date. It's very exciting in the demographic that it serves and the synergy that it has as far as the on-site services and the partners with the underlying current land owner. But this project was just hard to ignore because of the sheer numbers that they're bringing forward and the location. It's really the prime infill property within the city of Elk Grove when it comes to affordable housing adjacent to services and transit and all of the things that check the box. And also, as Sarah called out in her staff report, fairly low subsidy per door. It's about half of what the other projects were proposing as a per door subsidy. And I think that the mix of units, including those 80% units that are almost market rate, but not quite, then all serves a purpose for people who are just struggling and competing for the same small amount of housing that's available right now. I mean, we have a serious housing shortage, and this helps to fill that. And so I would second Councilmember Soon's motion and enthusiastically move this project forward.
Thank you, sir. Councilmember Spees, any further questions or comments?
Respectfully and appropriately, I think they squeezed the juice from the grape. I'm ready to support.
Likewise, I have nothing further to add other than thank you, Sarah. Excellent, excellent presentation. And also want to thank my colleagues, Councilmember Hume and Councilmember Soon, for serving on the committee and bringing back something that will go towards fulfilling a lot of needs in our community with our affordable housing shortage. So thank you all. So we have a motion and a second.
And just for Mr. Kelly's still online and listening, that we are, Ms. Bontrager has been coordinating with the city team. All we are awaiting is this approval tonight, and we will be poised. We should be able to meet his requirements in terms of the timeliness of the turnaround of the materials. But first, we need that approval. And so with the motion, the second, I will go to that roll call vote, starting with Councilmember Spees.
Aye.
Councilmember Hume.
Aye.
Councilmember Soon.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Nguyen is absent, and Mayor Singh Allen.
Aye.
And with that, the resolution of item 9.4 will pass 4-0.
All right, excellent. Let's go on to our next item.
will take us on to item 9.5, which is to receive information and consider an ordinance repealing and replacing Chapter 9.10 of the Elk Grove Municipal Code related to laundry and shopping carts.
How is that looking, Jason?
We've got your visuals, we've got your audio. Please proceed.
Thank you. Good evening, Mayor, members of the council. My name is Rosa Tapia. I'm your code enforcement manager. The item before you this evening is to receive information and consider an ordinance repealing and replacing Chapter 9.10 of the Elk Grove Municipal Code related to laundry and shopping carts. To provide some background, in 2000, the City Council adopted an urgency ordinance for all Sacramento County ordinances to remain in effect after incorporation, which created the Elk Grove Municipal Code Chapter 9.10 and provides for regulation of unauthorized use of laundry and shopping carts. You may recall during the June 9th City Council meeting, the council considered this proposed shopping cart ordinance. During that meeting, the council requested staff perform additional outreach, research, and return with information on research performed with the outreach performed with the California Grocers Association, outreach performed among retailers with frequent cart violations, options for individuals using carts to transport their purchased goods, and some research on other jurisdictions, their shopping cart ordinances, and what enforcement may look like within their jurisdictions. To provide a little more context on the outreach and research that was performed, staff was successfully connected with the California Grocers Association. We had a detailed discussion on the proposed ordinance and what that would look like within the city of Elk Grove. Staff extended an invitation to the Grocers Association to host a roundtable with their members. However, they didn't feel that that was needed at this time. The association stated they understood the need for an ordinance and have supported other jurisdictions adopting regulations that are consistent with state law. As you saw from an email received by the Director of Local Government Relations at the California Grocers Association, Mr. Tim James, they do support the adoption of our proposed ordinance and look forward to working with staff on the implementation should the council choose to adopt this ordinance this evening. Retailers with frequent cart violations. This outreach was specific to retailers that are not represented by the Grocers Association and in turn not a traditional grocery store. This accounts for approximately 35 of our retailers, which consists of superstores, pharmacies, and big box retailers. And staff emailed and mailed out a new letter explaining the need for a shopping cart ordinance in Elk Grove and outlined the proposed regulations in detail. These retailers were also provided a copy of the proposed ordinance. Staff was able to engage several of the retailers who stated they would be joining us this evening. So I'm looking forward to that. Options for individuals using carts to transport their goods. Council asked staff to examine options for individuals whose only option is to transport their goods via shopping cart. Staff connected with management from an apartment complex that's located along West Stockton and learned that this management at the complex is actively looking for a solution as the carts previously seen accumulated on the sidewalk are those that are found littered throughout their complex. In the meantime, staff has partnered with management and coordinated for carts to be placed in a designated location inside the complex pending the retrieval from the retailer. Management at this location has stated that they would support a collapsible cart checkout system for their tenants should the city sponsor carts to this complex. Staff is actively working on identifying funds that could help provide collapsible carts for these individuals. And then other jurisdictions. In my next slide, I'll share with you a regional survey. You may recall this table from your staff report. Staff performed a regional survey of other cities, their ordinances in place, and what enforcement looks like in their city. As you can see, cities have ordinances in place. However, from the feedback that I received and the research that I performed, they don't have the resources or the staffing to address this quality of life concern in their community.
There are two cities on this table who opted to contract with cart retrieval companies to address this concern in their community. One city has opted to pass on the cost to retailers. The other city has opted to budget and pay for the service. The last thing I want to cover on this table is out of the 10 cities that were surveyed, Rockland is the only one who was proactive and reactive in addressing shopping cart concerns within their community. They're also the city who was most recently adopted in their ordinance. I believe their ordinance was adopted in 2017. So they're the most recent one. Next, I want to cover the current regulations. As you may know, state law authorizes cities to impose regulations and enforcement mechanisms specific to shopping carts. Chapter 9.10 currently prohibits the unauthorized removal of shopping carts from the premises or parking areas of any business establishment. This chapter also prohibits abandonment of carts upon public or private property, including unauthorized possession when carts are unlawfully removed from owner's premises. It also prohibits using a shopping cart for any purpose other than its original intended use, in addition to prohibiting unlawful alteration of a cart without an owner's consent. Staff is recommending these prohibitions remain in place along with the proposed amendments. Before I discuss the proposed amendments, I want to touch on some enforcement challenges that were also discussed during the June 9th meeting. The enforcement challenges encountered by staff with the current prohibitions in place are that it becomes difficult for a code enforcement officer to enforce, as staff are not usually able to observe individuals violating the provisions I discussed in my previous slide. Generally, staff is left with only the aftermath of the violation, which is abandonment and littering of carts throughout the community. Although staff has partnered with store managers and cart retrieval companies to report abandoned carts, carts are generally not retrieved for several days after being reported, which results in code enforcement staff retrieving carts and returning them to its owner in order to reduce the nuisance and potential health and safety concerns that remain throughout the community. So the proposed amendments for Chapter 9.10, they are requirements for cart ID signs. This requirement allows staff to quickly identify who owns the cart for noticing purposes. This amendment also provides for revised language regarding the unauthorized removal or possession of a cart. Additional proposed regulations also include requirements for retailers to establish a mandatory plan to prevent cart removal from their premises only when repeat violations occur. What this means is this is not something that's going to be required of every retailer. As I mentioned in the June 9th meeting, Education First is our practice here in Elk Grove. And only after multiple attempts to partner with our retailers and communicate, whether it be in person and phone, would we then require a mandatory plan to be established? And so this is just an opportunity for us, code enforcement, city staff, to partner with retailers to develop that effective plan to maintain carts on their premises and in compliance with the city's municipal code. This proposed amendment would provide authority for impoundment, disposal, and enforcement. State law authorizes impoundment of carts by the city. Staff finds impounding rather than using city staff to return carts to its corresponding business would encourage retailers to establish a plan for proactively and timely retrieval of their carts. State law allows for disposal of unclaimed carts upon meeting the required noticing and 30-day storage requirements. Having authority to dispose of an unclaimed cart could act as a deterrent for retailers who just simply fail to take responsibility of their carts. Additionally, staff can seek using enforcement processes already in place as other enforcement tools for violations of these provisions. Some alternative actions is that the City Council could decide not to adopt a shopping cart ordinance. However, this would limit staff's ability to address the unauthorized removal and abandonment of carts throughout the community. The council could decide to direct staff to enter a contract with a cart retrieval company. The city would have to absorb cost of cart retrieval services, which would be an estimated cost of approximately $50,000. Staff's recommendation this evening is that the City Council repeal and replace Chapter 9.10 and adopt the new proposed amendments as they relate to laundry and shopping carts. That concludes my presentation, and I am available for questions.
All right, thank you so much, Rosa. At this time, I will go ahead and open up the public comment opportunity.
And for our attendees in the Zoom environment, now would be that opportunity. We do have someone that has the raised hand function, but any others, you can use the raised hand function as well. Mayor and council members, there was one email that was received earlier this evening, and that was forwarded to staff as well, but I think it was received direct to the City Council. But without further ado, I'll pull up that speaker timer so that we can pull in our speaker.
Rachel Espinoza, you may go ahead. You have 3 minutes.
Thank you very much. My name is Rochelle Espinoza. I'm the loss prevention supervisor for Winco Foods in Northern California. I oversee 21 different locations from Fresno North to the Oregon border. I just wanted to inform you of some of the struggles that we go through when it has to do with shopping cart retrievals and them leaving our property. Our goal is so that they don't leave the property. Our goal is obviously so that our customers can use these shopping carts. Each shopping cart costs anywhere from $274 to $350 a piece. We're an employee-owned company, so we try very hard to keep those shopping carts within our property. We have implemented a new system also where we lock up our shopping carts that are broken in the back so that they don't loosely end up dispersed throughout the city. We also have a retrieval system that we use where someone goes around and gathers carts and we pay them per cart as they return them on a regular basis and pay them invoices. We do work with other cities, specifically in the Bay Area, that do have implemented these kind of programs and city codes. One of the things that's been helpful that they've been able to do for us is when they do show up, because our carts are metal in some areas, they do show up at recycling centers or things like that. We actually get a phone call that our carts are there. Then we can then contact a retrieval service and or go retrieve our carts ourselves. Our goal is to keep all our carts on our property. But as Rosa said earlier, we're not able to really enforce much when they do remove from our property. I mean, we see it very much as theft. When the shopping carts do leave our property, and we would like to do everything we can to maintain that. We have in some certain areas too switched from metal carts to plastic carts because we have found that some camps like to utilize our metal carts as like barbecues and things like that. And at that point, we cannot repair them any longer. We do try to move the wheels off of one and put it on another. I mean, we have thousands of people come through our store a day, so those carts take quite a beating, and we do repair them. We just as an estimate, last month we had 200 broken carts. Now we only have 60 broken carts. We have a company that comes out with a welding machine and does repair these. I just kind of wanted to inform you of like what it is from a grocery standpoint on what our challenges are and how we are constantly trying to combat these issues. We do tell people that they can't have them and that they can't live with them. We do have an apartment complex and now housing next to us where we are finding the challenges of our shopping carts being over there, kind of scattered through the neighborhood. We do work with like the apartment complex behind us, hoping that they can help us at least leave it along the side of the street so that we can bring our cart hawks over there and retrieve those carts at that point. We haven't set up a new system yet for the housing next to us. And I know my time is almost up. But thank you guys for your time and all your hard work.
Thank you for calling in and providing us that additional information and insight. Any other callers?
And I'm not displaying any other raised hand features for item 9.5. So that'll conclude the public comment for item 9.5.
All right, I'll go ahead and close the public comment opportunity and open it up for council comments. Questions? I'll start with Councilmember Hume, since your camera came on.
Thank you. I actually had a question of Rosa. When we speak of the violations of the businesses, are those violations for the carts actually leaving the property, or they're violations to not get the carts retrieved in a timely manner?
It's for not retrieving the carts in a timely manner. Think it would be really challenging to enforce leaving the cart leaving the premises. Certainly, if that would be something we could observe regularly, we do have the ability to enforce that. But right now, today, we're more so speaking about the carts not being retrieved in a timely fashion.
Gotcha. Okay. Yeah, that makes much more sense. Appreciate it. I'd be willing to move the item.
All right. Thank you, sir. Thank you. We'll go on to Councilmember Soon. Any questions, comments?
Thank you, Mayor. No questions. Just think it's this is good for an extra deterrent. So I'll go ahead and second the item. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember Spies. Any questions or comments?
I do want to. I do support this. I do want to make one comment though on one of the options relative to finding or having carts at some of the apartments or housing developments nearby. And the city looking for funding. It, as was mentioned, it is costly for those grocery stores, supercenters as well. So it is entirely possible, and perhaps we can ask them, would they be willing to pay something like that or help us out with that to get the collapsible carts at those locations at their cost? Because again, $275, if you can avoid losing a cart, life is much better, right? So I just would offer that up as a suggestion to maybe just speak with some of those retailers and ask them to be partners with the city. I'm sure they have grants and things that will help. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Rosa, for your follow through from the council meeting that this was initially brought forward, specifically getting the support from the Grocers Association. It's always good to have support from the statewide association. And then, of course, doing your own due diligence with reaching out with the various retailers as well. I definitely appreciate Ms. Espinosa calling in as well. I think that was very helpful. I mean, the goal obviously is to, help preserve the retailers' assets, but also cleaning up our city and keeping Elk Grove beautiful. So it is a balanced approach. And I know that, obviously education is going to be the most important. We're not looking to be punitive, but at the same time, we want responsible business owners and being proactive in that. So thank you for doing your due diligence and getting that additional feedback. So I'm comfortable supporting this with all of the feedback that we've gotten and all of the research you've provided. We have a motion and a second on the floor.
I would ask is if the motioner, if you have the opportunity, is to read that motion in as an ordinance for item 9.5.
Councilmember Hume?
Yeah, give me just a second here and I'll pull it up. And that would be introduced and waive the full reading by substitution of title only, an ordinance repealing and replacing Elk Grove Municipal Code Chapter 9.10 related to laundry and shopping carts.
And thank you, sir. And we have the second there with Councilmember Suen. With that, I will move forward with the roll call vote, starting with Councilmember Spies.
Aye.
Councilmember Hume.
Aye.
Councilmember Suen.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Nguyen is absent, and Mayor Singh Allen.
Aye.
Ordinance of item 9.5 will pass 4-0.
All right, next item.
We'll take us to section 10, council comments, reports, and future agenda items.
All right, we'll start with Councilmember Spies.
I have nothing to report this evening. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Hume.
Hi, nothing to report relative to regional meetings, but I did want to bring up an item that I know, Mayor, you were copied on these emails as well regarding a resident who I don't think understood exactly which agency provides water, et cetera, but was talking about a rebate or an incentive program for WaterWise landscaping. I spoke with Sophia Sherman, who is on the Water District Board, the Resource Conservation District Board, and she would be interested in exploring that. So if we could have staff reach back out to the person, and her name escapes me at the moment, but to direct her to either Mr. Camillos, who is the general manager, and or to the Water District Board. I'd appreciate that. And so that we can look at doing that, you know, every drop is precious at this point.
Yes, agreed. Thank you. Councilmember Soon?
I'll waive my report this evening. Thank you.
All right. I did have Metro Air a couple weeks ago. I participated in a ride-along on Labor Day with Fire Chief Rodriguez and CSD General Manager Josh Green. We went and visited the Caldor Fire and got a firsthand look at just the devastation, literally rows and rows of just chimneys of what remains. So just wanting to do a shout out, of course, to all of our firefighters and our law enforcement personnel that have also been dispatched, not only for the Caldor Fire, but the Dixie Fire. Just thank you for your continued service. And you know, my heart goes out to all the families. It was very hard to see up close and personal. It was heartbreaking. And then today is also the 1 year anniversary for those, I think almost everyone on this council remembers him, Joel Broussard. Today's the 1 year anniversary that we lost him. And the family is doing a fundraiser to raise monies for a memorial bench. I've already donated, and I ask some of you that knew him to please chip in. There's a GoFundMe page. I can circulate that. Just a small token of our love and appreciation for someone who loved Elk Grove, was an excellent ambassador for our city, and really just always saw the good in people. So, but it's been 1 year since that tragic accident. I do see Councilmember Soon, your hand is up.
Yes, thank you, Madam Mayor. You know, first of all, thank you for bringing up Joel in his remembrance. And please send me that GoFundMe page. And secondly, you also reminded me of, it just escaped me, but today I just want to thank CSD Fire Chief Felipe Rodriguez and Police Chief Albright for going out to a demonstration that Chief Rodriguez allowed for his property to host, this Komodo fire retardant that you may have seen something similar on the news lately. But this was something that I think will hopefully benefit our community, whether it's through preventing grassland fires from 4th of July fireworks, or even what we see going on throughout the state right now. And so it's really great to be able to host a demo like that here in our city. And anyway, we'll see how things go forward. I'll stop there, but I just wanted to thank folks publicly.
Yep, thank you for that, sharing that report. And then last week, I also had an opportunity to visit the family of Officer Harminder Gariwal, who, as you recall, was the officer that succumbed to his injuries from that fatal car accident. Just tragic story. And I would like to adjourn this meeting in the memory of Officer Harminder Gariwal. May his memory be a blessing to his family and his friends. With that, I will adjourn this meeting. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you for that, Mayor. Good night.
Thank you. Good night, Mayor. Good night, everybody.